Assalamu alaikum and welcome to this week's An-Nur the Light. As we continue to commemorate Women's Month, it's important to remember that our mothers, sisters, wives and partners should be acknowledged, respected and encouraged to be the best versions of themselves, whatever that may be. Let's go meet a mogul in the making, Dimple Aisha.
Being a creative soul comes naturally to the highly talented Dimple Aisha. Designer, radio presenter, artist, and mom are some of the words used to describe her, but this by no means is going to be all.
I'm an African, mother of three boys, a Tanzanian wife, and a proud African Muslim. I'm a lover of development. Women empowerment, yes, but a bit of mixed feelings, but it's all about social empowerment and more of the local economic development, because there's such an imbalance. But for me, anything that's got to do with humanitarian and social upliftment, that says me, it resonates with Dimple.
The road to success is often filled with obstacles, and navigating these are what makes or breaks an individual. Aisha recognizes her weakness as well as her strength and makes sure to nurture each one of it equally.
The whole course is called the Five Pillars of Empowerment, and it's a course that's sponsored by Women of Stature and Nedbank. It's a business course, but firstly, I think with everything else, you have to fix what's within yourself. So we do personal branding and personal mastery with that and with art as well, because you can't empower other people whereas you're not empowered. But sometimes when you're a people's person or you love doing community work, you give out so much of yourself and then you get so drained. Oh, the painting day was amazing because it relieved the child in me. I always thought I'm such a bad artist. I've always thought I'm not creative, but the painting, it brought out something in me where you put yourself and just completely forget about the existence of anything and just focus on you and your inner self and your inner feelings and play with that. And actually anything just becomes what you see and what you believe in. And having to pick what you put on your collage is like, what resonates with you. What I had in the picture was a splash of paint with all my mixed emotions, the brokenness, the storms of everything in my life were all in that colors. And the wording that came for me was, dreams are the whispers of the soul. And half the time I personally felt I gave up on so much of my dreams to leave for certain things. And at that moment, I needed my dreams to be the whispers of my soul. So in that painting and in that color, that's where I had my dreams.
Being a radio presenter came quite naturally and allowed Dimple Aisha to create a show where she was able to engage with people from all walks of life.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to The Common Space. The time is 10 minutes past 10 and I am with my co-host Mamolefe, and we've missed you guys. So we were asked and approached by Salam Media because we've collaborated with them in their previous campaigns in the township area. It's basically in Attridgeville in Pretoria. So when they approached us, they wanted to have a show, and it kind of sounded very crazy, like I have no radio experience or nothing, and how do you get us on A? So the common space was for them to allow everybody to come into the space, and Salam Media allowed us to be diverse, as that where we interview people who are from all diverse angles of South Africa. So it's basically sharing untold stories of everyday people. That's maybe what the show is. My clothing line is about identity of myself, of my inner being, and acknowledging who I am without fail, and accommodating that I'm Muslim. So it's a modest African way, which is more about the stuff that I personally like. With the African kimono, it's sort of wanting something that's easy and light for women. You know, we love jeans. Sometimes when you're not properly dressed and you always worry, oh, I'm not covered well enough. And with that, it was just throw over. But now it was something that, like, again, it still had to resonate with the identity of me being an African Muslim, but also the love of either Western or Indian fashion fabric, because I love fabric, so it doesn't matter which fabric it is. So putting it together with that, with harem clothing, was to say we're embracing all identities, so we're doing that. So the African kimono was blending it all together and saying we're modest, we're African, and the kimono is gonna be all diverse.
No person gets to where they are without the support of family and friends, and Dimple Aisha can count on hers to be there whenever she needs them.
Having my hands in different pies is for me to have an impact in life. I think that's the biggest thing for me. And being a Muslim, I struggled a lot with my self-esteem, with myself as a person, because I come from Lesotho. It's a very small country, and I've always been black, and there was nothing wrong with that. You know, I never had to validate myself or affirm myself in a community, and then I moved full-time to South Africa. Yeah, then there's race and all that. And then I became Muslim, and that like the highlight of it, where race was really an issue. And I always had to have my fences up and defend myself, which was emotionally draining. So me being part of certain projects that I've been in was for me to say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to prove myself and be and show people that as a black person, as a Muslim, I am South African. You know, because even the black people, when they see you, they think, oh, you're foreigner, and they speak about you and assume you can't hear. But it's just to raise awareness to the people that there are black South African Muslims living amongst us, and also that you can be black and want to be something and want to be a change maker and do all that. So that what drives me to do most of the stuff that I do.
In order to live fulfilled lives, we often stretch ourselves to the limit, and sometimes even beyond. This is okay if we are able to replenish what we expend in meaningful ways. As Dimpo Aisha is finding it, it takes a lot to attain the empire you're looking for. But with hard work, anything is possible.
And there you see it for yourselves, another young Muslim woman who is reaching for the stars and being a superhuman by taking care of business, family, and life. Let's check out this week's Street Style.
Refrapt is the scarf styling company that I started a year and a half ago. It's predominantly pin-free scarves that is used for turban styling as well as normal scarf styles. And I also have a range of Georgette scarves. Another part of Refrapt is the turban styling workshops that I host, where I teach ladies how to wrap turbans. It's an interactive workshop where ladies come to the classes to learn about 5 different turban styles. It's interactive, and I help them through the different styles as well. With the turbans, I generally always used to do turbans. You know, as a Muslim female, wearing headscarf is part of our religion. But then I wasn't always comfortable with, you know, because I'm a very hot person, I don't do well with being fully covered as yet. So the turbans was just always second nature for me. Modesty, when choosing my outfits, modesty is a very important factor for me. I want to be covered and comfortable in the sense that I'm also dressing according to my religion. So I'm always covered from top to bottom and always but trying to be as fashionable as possible as well. So for me, a turban is part of who I am at this point. It's also a representation of my brand. It's also, for me, I feel that it is very comfortable to wear. It doesn't move around and things like that. And as I am a girl on the go, I need that in my life. I can't spend 5-10 minutes 4 or 5 times a day readjusting my scarf. So it's ideal for me.
Cryptocurrency has become one of the buzzwords of the past year, and we felt it necessary to shed some light on it.
Cryptocurrency is taking the world by storm as more and more people warm up to the idea of having their money stored in a digital wallet and accessible through their computers or phones. The platform that drives cryptocurrency is known as blockchain and can be described as the nucleus of the technology.
Blockchain is a computer technology that captures transactions between parties in such a way that once a transaction is on the chain, it can't be removed. And the chain verifies all the parties. It's a way of trusting a record of transactions. So let's define what cryptocurrencies are. It's a token, it's a digital token that is created on the blockchain. And those tokens can be used as currency. They get their value from the fact that the network works well. Transactions flow and people are able to transact on the network.
Digital currencies use blockchain technology to ensure that nobody can control, own, or manipulate its transactions. Users are able to buy and exchange crypto using these platforms in a relatively safe environment.
In the cryptocurrency case, it's using the same blockchain technology, but the transactions themselves are in fictional tokens, but in a way that is immutable. Once you've transacted with it, it can't be changed. It's traceable, it's verifiable that the right parties are the ones that actually transmit it. So think of it as transactions, but now of fictional tokens.
In 2008, an unknown group or person known only by the pseudonym Satoshi Nakamoto introduced Bitcoin, a digital currency that made use of blockchain technology, bringing with it the start of digital currencies as we know it. As with all financial investments, however, one must consult the Sharia, and this has opened up the Islamic debate on cryptocurrency.
As far as cryptocurrencies are concerned, there are several approaches from an Islamic perspective. Because it's work in progress, different scholars, Sharia scholars, have different approaches. Sheikh Nizam Yaqubi, who's the Mufti of Bahrain, who's an internationally renowned scholar also in Islamic finance, his opinion was that money as a medium of exchange, today we have fiat money which is not backed by the gold standard, is a piece of paper, but of course it may be, some may say it's backed by an economy, or it becomes legal tender, the state recognizes it and everybody uses it. So the same point he raised, he said, look, through commercial usage over a period of time, these cryptocurrencies may also take the place of fiat currency in the sense that it will be accepted in a broader community as money or as a means of exchange. Like, for example, from a Sharia perspective, it's not necessary that money has to be gold and silver or fiat money in the sense of paper money. But the principle of having an arrangement like Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies outside the conventional regulated framework of the banks, it's a principle which one can accept. I mean, it may prove to be useful or beneficial to the community over a period of time.
With the ability to shape how business is done, blockchain is being used by many companies in South Africa to ensure verifiable transactions in their systems. IBM, the largest computer company in the world, has been making use of this technology.
One of our best examples is in the shipping industry. You know how when a ship of goods arrives, there's a whole document trail that needs to be approved, government officials need to approve, the shipping companies need to be involved, and that chain of documents is a perfect candidate for the blockchain. There's a project underway in terms of food safety. Imagine if you tracked the well-being of food from farm to the consumer on the blockchain. So there's an exciting project where we track and record changes to the state of the food as it goes through the chain. In the African context, we want to solve African problems. We're looking for the pain point. Where's the inefficiency? Where can blockchain benefit certain processes? And the one that we've immediately stumbled across is this case of logistics, transferring goods to spaza shop owners. They can download an app that allows them to order goods, take out a loan, check on their status, and repay the loan. So this is an example of how IBM closes the loop. We provide everything, the blockchain and the user interface.
As the debate on cryptocurrency in an Islamic context continues, it is clear that blockchain technology as a whole certainly has its uses and merits.
I'm a Muslim IBM researcher, so I often look for ways that my religion informs my day-to-day life, my research, and I love the fact that there's a strong resonance here between the values of Islam and blockchain. You trust the Quran, you trust the Prophet, peace be upon him, and it's his character, his life story that builds your trust so that you can believe in the truth. In the case of blockchain, it's a brilliant mechanism for trusting the transactions on the chain without having to necessarily trust the parties, because the trust is built in the way verification is done, with digital signatures and a chain of transactions. I love that connection between trust, truth, and and religion encouraging justice, transparency, verifiability.
From an Islamic perspective, custom and usage has a very wide role to play. In the earlier generations, there were certain categories of property that were never recognized in those communities. For example, intellectual property, trademarks, patents, goodwill, and so forth, copyright. These were intellectual property. You can't touch and feel them. Today, the Global Fiqh Academy has recognized them as property based on commercial usage. Digital currency, for the time being, is obviously a sensitive area. But over a period, depending on how it works out and pans out and works, and if more and more people buy into this, and it may then acquire the stamp of a currency.
In the words of Bob Marley, the sun is shining, the weather is sweet. Yes, I know it's still practically winter, but there are signs all around of the changing weather. Our travel segment shows you great places to see, things to do, and some yummy halal food to eat.
The KwaZulu-Natal Midlands Meander has something for everyone. And with many artists who've chosen to settle here, there is an abundance of things to do for the visitor.
Me and my husband Jan, we do the stained glass together. And then I do the ceramics. We do stained glass mostly for people on commission. Doors for their houses, windows, and then of course the stained glass lights that you can see behind us.
The establishment caters not only to the shopper, but also to the creator. On offer are courses in pottery making, mosaics, and being an outlet for the creative soul inside of you.
So we've got different classes. You can come and make pottery. All you have to do is you have to phone us and say, we want to actually make pottery from scratch. We'll wet the clay for you and we'll roll the clay for you. We'll have everything ready. You pay 100 rand per hour so that you actually will make something, and we'll let it dry and we'll choose your colors and we'll fire it in the kiln, and it will be something that you can use. You can also, we have mugs and kettles and all kinds of things like that you can paint, and we'll glaze it and we'll fire it for you, and you can take it home. We also do mosaics. Then you can make mosaics and you take it home the same day.
Once the fun of creating is done, it's time to exercise, and hiring a bike is both physically rewarding as well as therapeutic.
Besides the classes, which we can just pop in and do for an hour or two, we've got bicycle rental, so you can rent your bicycle. Sometimes people come and they get their bicycles here and they just go around Nottingham Road. So they visit the BFL and the Junction and Gowrie Centre and have lunch somewhere, and they come back with their bicycles. Bicycles are 75 rand an hour. The bicycles are suitable from about 8 years old to 80, depending on how fit you are. And you can have them for the whole day. If you just want to come for an hour, it's 50 rand an hour. So you really experience nature up close. It's a much better way to experience the Midlands.
Honey is one of the oldest food sources known to human beings. It is both nutritional as well as medicinal, and is often seen as a healthy alternative to other sweeteners.
Peel's Honey is the oldest honey brand in the country. Been going since 1924. Peel's sells a variety of products, not only honey, but also our peanut brittle, all the brittle range, not only peanut brittle, but we have macadamia, peanut, hazelnut, and a number of others as well.
This store's fame spreads far and wide, as the honey produced here is of great quality. Many visitors often stop along the way between Johannesburg and Durban to stock up on their favorite items.
People quite often think that honey is only one taste, one color, and in the meantime, it's so much more than that. All the plants that we get honey from give off a different flavor, aroma, as well as density. So we've got honey that's from sugarcane, which is sort of molasses, kind of looking and flavor. Sunflower is also very light in color, and that's one of our favorites, as we use it as raw honey. We at Peel's have, as I said, all our own hives, so it's all local South African honey. Peel's has recently been Halal accredited and Sanha accredited. And so all our Peel's products are Halal registered.
The Holy Quran has dedicated an entire chapter to the bees. And in this shop, visitors are able to get up close and watch them in action.
Not only is Peel's about honey, but it's also educating the public about the importance of bees and beekeeping, which without the bees, we as humans would battle to exist. So part of our philosophy is the education side of it as well. Hence the observation hive in the back.
For anyone with a bee in their bonnet, this would be a good place to stop to get rid of it. Honey has and will always sweeten the taste of our memories and palates as we indulge in this ancient of products.
I would be failing my duty if I did not acknowledge the period we are in, the month of Dhul-Hijjah. Hujjaj are about to embark on the most important few days of their lives, and we would like to wish them a safe and peaceful journey as they answer the call, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. To everyone else, have a blessed Eid al-Adha. Assalamu alaikum from me, Sahra Robinson.
A long, hard road you travel every day. So many struggles that you're facing. But you're gonna get through it anyway. Cause you just smile, you're going places. You kick down to the ground and you're hurting, all hope is gone. Never ever give up, no you can't. Dust yourself off and get up again, get up again. Cause when the time comes and you're standing before your Lord, that's the only time that you truly win. Cause you never gave up, never gave in. So get up again, get up again. Fist clenched, mouth dry, but you cannot speak out, can't even cry. Somehow you feel like you're dead inside. Cause no one hears you, no that's not true. Cause Allah's there no matter where you are. He sees you, so he allows you to shine. You're gonna be fine. Bring out the hero hidden inside. So don't give in, you fight till the end. The reason we fall is to get up, get up, get up again. You kick down to the ground and you hurt and all hope is gone. Never ever give up, no you can't. Dust yourself off and get up again, get up again. Cause when the time comes and you're standing before your Lord, that's the only time that you truly win. Cause you never gave up, never gave in. So get up again, get up again.
Every one of us has a journey, and the hard times is the story. When you push through what you've been through, come out on the other side brand new. I know I make it sound easy, but it's always there, believe me. When you keep on the extra mile, expect God to make it worth your while. And turn your frown into a smile, and you don't even know how. How you made it, I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world.
You kick down to the ground and you hurt and all hope is gone. Never ever give up, no you can't. Dust yourself off and get up again, get up again. Cause when the time comes and you're standing before your Lord, that's the only time that you truly win. Cause you never gave up, never gave in. So get up again, get up again.
Trust in God's plan. Get up and try.
God has a plan.
Yeah.